Well, both, thanks for coming on. Thanks for jumping on and be willing to tell your story. So let's start with, what's your name, where were you born, where did you grow up?
Yeah, so Tim Groundwater, born in Gympie, 1988, and grew up in Gracemere pretty much.
Yeah, nice. What age, how old were you when you moved to Gracie?
Five.
Yeah. So have you lived here your whole life?
Or yeah, pretty much. Oh, we lived in Jeringa for a bit, went to school out there and that, but then, yeah, I just moved back to Rocky.
So you went to Rocky High, North Rocky High, then Blackwater High.
Had to get a job, but because Mum wouldn't let me leave school without having a job. So
tell us about that. tell us about the high school. Tell us about your high school life, and then because you mentioned you had to get a job then.
Yep.
So tell us about what you remember of high schooling, and then transitioning into.
I hated it. Like,
why did you hate it?
I don't know. Just
school sucks.
Yeah. So
yeah.
Yeah, I got, I left it in, a couple of months into grade 11 sort of thing and started working. Never liked high school. It was shit. She said you're not leaving school unless you've got a job. So I was straight in the newspaper, found one.
Well, you just stopped there. Oh, can I stop you there? I reckon kids wouldn't know these days how to find a job in the newspaper.
Probably not.
Yeah, how did you do it?
Got the newspaper and flipped it open and did the tie fitting job in there, and I was like, I'll give that a crack.
Job at the Ambassador.
Right. Tom Layden ties. But so I done work experience at the tie fitting place in Blackwater and enjoyed it, but then when I finally left school and was working there, it wasn't the best job, but I was out of school, so that was my main goal.
That was your main goal. You ticked the box there. You're like, well, I'm not going to finish school.
Yeah.
Mum says, I've got to get a job. I've got a job. You got to start at the mechanic shop. The tie shop.
But Jared and Jenny Falaba owned the tie shop in Gracemere, Tom Layden's, when I started there. Really
Tom
nice
Layden's.
People.
Yeah. I know who you're talking about. I don't know them, but I know the business.
Yeah.
So they gave you your start.
Yep.
Kind of thing. Kicked you off. Was it a traineeship?
That was just a job. I done a 2-week trial, and then they're just like, you're pretty much got the job.
So did you get your trade?
I don't know if it is a trade or whether it's just a qualification. It's pretty easy work, but backbreaking, dodgers and
backbreaker bars. 15?
Yeah, 16. Yeah.
Swinging off a...
Yeah, oh, well, yeah, 15 and a bit.
Swinging off a big breaker bar.
Breaker bar and stuff, yeah.
Yeah, nice. Lucky you're a big
boy. I was always a pretty big lad, so it's pretty easy, yeah.
Yeah, they would have given you the heavier work straight up.
Mm.
And how long did you do tie fitting for, bro?
About 18 months, I think it was.
Yeah.
And then got a gig in the Horizon. Right. Queensland Rail back then.
Right. So you grew up in Gracie, so you grew up here in Rocky, you went to high school here, bit of Blackwater, then you transitioned into that work sort of stuff, and mum's obviously said get a job.
Yeah,
you can't leave school. So you've gone and done that. You got your job, 18 months tie fitting, and how does QR sort of start coming into play and all that sort of?
So I got a job in the railway. I was still tie fitting then, but bloke that mum knew asked if she had any young lads that wanted a job, and she said I got twin boys, so. That's where the railway gig kicked off, sort of thing.
Righto, so you're a twin.
Yeah. Twin brother Jake, yeah.
Twin brother Jake, yeah. Righto, there you go. So who's older out of the...
Jake's older, yeah.
Jake's older.
Baby of the family.
Oh, yeah.
Brothers will fight and
who's
stuff.
Who's the better looking, you reckon, out of you and Jake?
Oh, definitely me.
Yeah, 100%. You're going to say yourself then.
You're going to back yourself in for sure
every day of the week. Well, what's that make you, 17 and a half?
I was just shy of 17, when I started in the railway.
Like, that's young, eh?
Worked with a lot of older blokes, sort of, they'd... I think the youngest back then was 25 or something. So 17-year-old going straight into a more mature workplace.
How did you find that coming in?
I enjoyed it.
What was back then, especially QR, mining, construction, all that sort of stuff. We were quite so they were a lot different to what they are now.
Yeah.
I know. I went in as a young fella, and
That's when the banter was still in full
when
swing.
When you're allowed to say things that you can't say today and really give it to people.
Not many snowflakes back then. 16 years I've been there.
16 years. And what have you... so you started off, what were you doing first when you first started?
Labourer. Yeah. Straight up. So, like overhead linesman, like offside and them sort of thing. But back then, even being a labourer, we pretty much done the work that the tradies were doing.
So tell us a little bit about your apprenticeship. So what is your apprenticeship?
It's the trades, a traction lines person.
Yep.
So it's just sort of with the railway, like... Yep. You can go down to Sydney, Melbourne, all that is all traction, where like trains, trams and sort of thing. And then you've got the distro, which is Ergon sort of work. So to get to Ergon, you've got to do more modules and it's a lot harder there. Capstone test is next month. And we just got a couple of...
Been heaps of maths?
My 9 weeks in TAFE, I could have sworn my hair was falling out from stress.
you grew up... Here, you went to school between here and Blackwater. You started working at a fairly young age. I think when you were about 15, you said you started working. And when did you, we'll talk about mental health, because I know you've got quite a story to tell on that. Did you begin to realise that things were starting to go bad for you on a personal level?
Probably around about 19, 20 maybe.
Yep.
Yeah, started, not feeling right sort of thing, like didn't know what was going on, that sort of thing. Like,
what did not feeling right, like do you know what kind of what was, you knew something was that?
Yeah, because I wasn't myself.
So
anxiety was a big thing for me, I'd...
But you didn't know, am I right in saying you didn't know what
it was? Never knew that until only... 2 years ago.
Yeah.
So
not knowing what anxiety was, what did it feel like then? If you know what I mean, because now you can recognize, is that right?
Yeah, sort of. Yeah. I don't know. It's hard to describe how it feels, sort of thing.
Yeah.
But for me, it was if I had to go to shopping fair, say Stockland's big shopping center in Rocky, my eyes would just be on the ground, It was just like, just I didn't like big crowds. It was that kind of thing. I don't know. You just get, I can't do this. In and out.
It's like getting worked up. I never knew either before, but I'd feel like I'm getting angry, but I don't know if I'm getting angry at.
Yep.
I'm like, what's going on here? All right. So you're 19, 20. Yep. Tell me about that. What started happening for you? We'll go through where that ended up and kind of where you're at today.
Drinking obviously affects your mental health more, but at the time you think it's like a little bit of an escape sort of thing. But pretty much drink every afternoon after work, pretty heavily.
I'm not trying to suggest anything to you, but it would... It'd nearly be normal though, wouldn't it?
Hard, play hard, sort of.
Yeah, I mean, have you been drinking? You come in.
Yeah, since I was only 17. Yeah,
and you're working like, and I'm assuming drinking hard.
You just
keep on drinking. Did you start using drugs then? A little bit later?
About 18. I smoked a bit of marijuana and that when I was younger, sort of thing. But then, when I started in the railway, they said you get drug and alcohol tested, and I was like, I'm going to stop smoking pot because I knew that stays in your system and a job like that, it's not worth the risk sort of thing. And then, started taking drugs at nightclubs and shit like that.
Just a few party.
Yeah, yeah.
Just few pingers. Yeah, a
couple
mixes.
Of pingers. Yeah, yeah. It just got worse after that pretty much.
I'm really keen to dig into your story. You've got a really good story, man. I really want to explore some of that with you, and especially where you're at now. I think it's really important and kind of where you came from. So you started on the party drug scene. What did you always be direct by? Did you kind of stay with the pingers? Did you try other stuff?
Yeah, for a little bit. Yep. Probably a year or so. Then tried some speed and that was a bit better than the pingers sort of thing. And
sort of wise you up pretty good, eh?
Yeah, that was good for a party anyway. Yeah, but
was your use just, did it stay recreational, or did it become something that you kind of relied on?
No, it stayed recreational for like a fair while. Like it was just on the weekends sort of thing. And then gradually, well, towards like the end before I got help for my mental health is when I was like waking up wanting it sort of thing. But
and you weren't just using, what were you using then?
That was the ice then.
Yeah.
Got onto that when I was about 22, 23.
Yep, so that came a bit later.
Speed dried up pretty quick, like it was.
Talk to us a little bit about your experience there with ice, and if you don't mind.
Oh, it's an insane drug, like very good while powerful. You're using it. Oh yeah, yeah.
But absolutely
insane crash, come down, like you just. I think that's when you start using heavier is the come down stage, and you're like, oh, I've got to have more, because you just feel like absolute shit. So.
Yeah, so would you say you're starting to come down, you're starting to feel shit, so then you're like all those endorphins that were released when you had that, you know, first puff or eat it or snort it or whatever, you do it again to kind of
get that, just to feel that bit better than, like, crash and hard.
And it just becomes what we both know is
just
a roller coaster.
Just a wave. Up, down, up, down.
Tell me what your head was like during that time.
Oh, a mess.
Yep.
Like, seeing shit, hearing shit, like putting in a sense of paranoia, if you will.
Yeah.
Like, definitely not. The longer you stay up, the worse it is. Oh, only 4 days or so, but it's.
And definitely, now would you stay
awake? Oh, not a chance. No way. Yeah, I know. drinking now, I prefer to start at midday, so I'm in bed by 7. Like,
that's what I was going to say. Now as you start your beer, you have a beer early. So you started, we'll just backtrack a little bit. You started using ice. Well, you're obviously hanging around a lot of people that you could, I mean, that we know that.
Yeah, it's a scene.
You sort of form that group like that.
I don't talk to quite a few who are still in that scene, but it's you got to do things to better yourself, eh?
Yeah.
Like, I was stuck in that scene for most part of my adult life, sort of thing. So,
do you think you lost a part of your life then? Like, do you think or
It was it was a bad stage in my life, but I didn't lose it. I guess it's a part of building who you are as a person, sort of thing, growing up. You know what I mean? Like, so.
I know it's tough for you to talk about.
Got bloody goosebumps.
Yeah, and it's been a rough ride for you, bro.
Yeah.
It was. So how long did you use ice for, like, roughly?
10, 12 years, probably. Yeah,
that's a fucking long time.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, how long's it been now?
Nearly 3 years in October it'll be.
Yeah.
So, and that's, I went to a psychologist and sort of, like, I don't open up to people. I'm a quiet person, sort of thing. So me in a psychologist room, I was like, you know.
Tell us a story about the it's a little funny story.
I'd actually been on the ice all night and remembered at about 5 o'clock in the morning that I actually had a psychologist appointment, my first ever one, and I was like obviously wired up a bit and sort of freaking out and went in there and like a couple of things he said, like, it spun me out. Like, obviously this is, you know, what it does to your head. Like, he said something about the sprinklers, like, and I was like, oh yeah, I didn't think anything of it. Like, I'm pretty sure he said something about, I'll just go and turn the sprinkler off. And I was sitting in this room and I'm like looking around and like freaking out, sort of thing. And he came back in and then he said, oh, like, got a bit onto my story, sort of thing, and said about drug use and that. And I said, yeah. And he said, oh, when was the last time you used ice? I said, this morning. He goes, oh, you seem pretty relaxed for someone who's been on ice, like, just hours ago.
Yeah.
And he said, he said, I believe you might have undiagnosed ADHD. And he said, oh, like, have you ever used any, like, tobacco, alcohol? I said, yeah, I quit smoking cold turkey. I said, a lad at work said, oh, you won't be able to quit. And I did.
Yeah.
And the psychologist said to me, he said, if you want to get off the ice, he said, tobacco is the hardest drug, if you will, to get off. And he said to me, he said, stop being so weak. And that sort of clicked in my head, and I was like, yeah, well, if I can give up tobacco, I can give up the ice.
Yeah.
And that was where it pretty much started. Not instantly that day.
Yeah, like, of course. Yep.
A little bit after that, like a couple of, you know, more sessions on it and that. Yep. And then I was just like, yeah, that's when I was really bad at that stage. Like, yep. Had weight loss surgery in 2018, and that messed with my head a lot, because always been a big bloke, getting all the nutrients and that, and then it went to nothing, and especially using where you don't eat.
Where you don't eat.
Yeah, so I was on a diet of green bean Doritos for quite a while there. And yeah, so...
We know a bit about that diet,
yeah,
eh?
So, yeah, definitely, yeah. Yeah, definitely not a healthy choice there. So that's...
Also, you've got very minimal nutrients going in. All you're then taking in is some meth and some V and Doritos, your favourite. Was there any noticeable health effects on you? Do you remember anything kind of out of the ordinary that was happening for you during that time?
Like if I got up quick, I'd get dizzy and I'd put my head through the oven there one time. And yeah, the nephew asked me to peel an apple for him, and I jumped up out of bed, and next minute I woke up and I could hear this crackling, and it was the oven door glass falling around me. Like, so yeah, it was a pretty funny story, because he said to Brianne, my sister, he said, oh, Mum, Uncle Tim came out, and then he just had a little sweep. I woke up on the floor. So, yeah.
What prompted you? Was there anything that prompted you to go to the psych, or did you just kind of wake up and go, oh, yeah, today's the day, I'm going to go see the psych? Or did
I'm not like that. I actually made an appointment with a doctor and got a mental health care plan.
Yep.
And then, he gave me 5 sessions to this psychologist, and I went to 2, and I just, I don't open up to people. I just knew that I was deteriorating fast towards the end of my addiction, so.
And did you have, you spoke about your sister, so did you have her, like, did you have her around as a support kind of?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. So she was completely unaware of my drug use at the time, so. But
so
then,
was she unaware, like, the whole time, or...?
Yeah, yeah, I'm pretty sure she was, yeah.
So she only just kind of found out recently as
well.
That would have been big for
3
her.
Years ago, yeah.
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 And did you kind of
massive.
Break that news to her?
Yep.
And how did you, how did that go down?
Better than I thought. Better than I thought, because I was, you know, like, there's a lot of stigma around ice that, you know, it's bad shit, which it is, but, you know, like, there's different types of
addicts. You were still functioning.
Oh, yeah, I was still working.
Still working, holding a job,
yeah.
You're doing the trade, you know.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes that we can justify that. I know, you know, in my past I've justified, well, I'm still contributing to society. I'm not as bad as those guys.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, your head's fucked.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, so let's fast forward. Let's go to the you're seeing the psych. Let's go from there. What's kind of your journey from that point?
So then from that point, like I said, a couple of more times I smoked it, and then I just woke up one day and I was like, this shit's killing me. I'm going to commit suicide if I keep going on this shit. Like, at the end of 2018 was when I was really, really low and thinking about suicide. And, hang on. So then I don't know how it stemmed from that, but sort of, giving it up really, really wrecks you, because you've been on it for that many years.
Yeah.
It's struggle to get out of bed, even to do your daily tasks, and that was really hard. And that's how I went back to it a couple of times, and then
just so you can get out of bed.
Yeah, you know, like just to half function.
Yeah,
and then I ended up breaking it to Brianne, and she was like, she's my rock.
Yeah,
she was.
Yeah. Who's that? That's
Brianne, my sister. Yeah, I've lived with her since I was pretty much 15. When I started, it started as a Thai fitter. I left home and was living with my sister.
Okay, so Brian, she's kind of raised that teenage party that you've lived with her. So she only found out your heavy drug use 3 years ago.
Yep.
Yeah, wow. Yeah. You sneaky boy.
Yeah.
But I just want to go back and I hope you're okay to answer the question. You just mentioned suicide there. Can you talk a little bit to that and to other blokes who what that was like to actually go through and how you actually felt in those moments, because I know those are quite important.
So I was obviously pretty low, and that was a thought that crossed my mind, but at the same time I couldn't do it, so, and that's where I sort of the depression sort of after you stop the usage. And so that's a thing with depression is you want to die, but you don't want to sort of thing. It messes with you a lot. So
yeah, it's kind of pulling you. Kind of, if I can imagine, you want to die, you don't want to be here.
Yeah.
But I don't really want to die, but I just don't want this shit that's going on right now to keep on happening.
Exactly.
Is that right?
Yeah. Exactly. Yep.
So that's a head fuck.
So I battled on like that for, I'd come good for a bit, and then every now and again I'd break down, have a cry sort of, and then I'd done that for 2 years, and then I just broke right down, and Breanne said I will go to the doctor and that, and that's when I got on to my medication that would have been just before Christmas last year, I think, 2019.
Yep.
And, it's just
you've jumped over there. Let's go back. Yeah, so we're getting to the good stuff. it's all good stuff. But we're getting used now, coming out. So you're using for 10, 12 years. You're drinking, you're working, you're getting a trade. Then you've got all this head noise going on.
Yep.
And you didn't know then you've got anxiety, and you've talked about depression and the suicide. And you battled with that, for a couple of years after you've... I'm quitting. And then we know that there's a process to quit. As you quit, you go in these little waves of up and down. And there has come, I guess, the anxiety and depression, as you said, has started to come in. And then you've had that for 2 years, and then you've broken to your sister and said everything's really fucked. So this is,
I was sick of being too strong. It's easy to put a fake smile on.
Yeah.
But inside it fucks you up.
You've gone to Brianne and said, what do I do? Tell me about that, man. So you've battled. It's been a 12-year battle.
Yep.
Tell me about going to your sister and then what you did from there.
I just broke down.
Yeah.
And so that, she got straight onto the internet and booked an appointment for the next day.
Yep.
And came with me because, I'm not good at talking about that sort of thing. And
big strong blokes.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's hard, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
It's not normal.
Because,
I mean, if I look at what you've told me today, you don't talk about the shit that's happened.
So we went there and that he sort of, like Brianne said, the feeling of emptiness sort of alone, that's what I felt like sort of thing. And so he's put me on this medication. He said it won't take effect for a couple of months or whatever. And so the first probably fortnight, I was having the best sleep I'd ever had in 12 years on these tablets. And I was
He gave you some medication?
Yep.
What did you say to the doctor? What did the doctor say to you?
He said,
what did you do? Was there a plan put in place?
With that sort of medication, he said, it's trial and error. Some work for some people, some don't. So you got to jump through, there's about 12 different kinds, I think he said.
Oh, good, just what you need.
Yeah, yeah. So I was like, oh, great, here we go.
Yeah, he has my anxiety through the roof again.
He nailed it.
He nailed it. First go.
Got you
on the meds.
Yep.
You started taking them 2019?
Just before Christmas, 2019.
So what are we in now?
I think 21.
So you've been on a year and a half.
Yep.
So, all right. So 12 years use. You decide to try and make a change. You break it to your sister. You have that little period of where you're just battling on your own.
Yep.
And then you come to your sister again and say, actually, yep. I don't know what the fuck's going on. My yep. head's fucked.
Yep.
And I need some help. What else is out there?
Yep.
You go to a doctor. You get on 2019 now. You get on the meds.
Yep.
Tell me what's happening 2019 till now.
So, yep, like I said, on the medication.
Yep.
Doing the apprenticeship, sort of way better sleep. Started feeling better after the few months type yep. thing, and so from there until now,
yep,
been great, yeah. Yep.
And what does so you know tell what are some of the things you're doing or that you have done for yourself since and you've been what are some of the things sorry that you've been able to do since you stopped using, since you've gotten some medication and getting help with your mental health? What are some of the things that you notice now that you're doing that you weren't really doing
before? Well, I can walk through Stocklands without looking at the ground. I did sign up to a gym, but yeah. I haven't yeah. really gone.
A couple of times?
Went a couple of times.
I remember you were doing a heap of
walking. I was doing a heap of walking and then sort of just, faded out of that. But
yeah.
it's I was feeling really good when I was walking and that, so... Yeah. Might have to get there, brush the cobwebs off the shoes.
Brush your assets off.
Yeah.
Man, that's unreal. Like, that's a huge, like you said, a huge chunk of your adult life. And, you know, it's massive for you to be telling other blokes, it's why we have this platform,
yeah.
about the steps you did. What are some of the, I just want to go back to when you decided that this was enough, and so this is before the kind of, you know, cooling off period, I call it, where we're still trying to come off.
Yeah.
What were some of the key things for you? I know you did some really specific things to help yourself stay away from it. What were some of those things? Do you remember? You made some real distinct decisions about this is what I'm going to do, and this will help me not fall back into the trap. Do you remember what
they were? I think one of them was the company I was hanging around. I sort of...
Did you hear from them?
Nah.
Funny that.
The phone rings. Oh, yeah, I'm not going to answer that one.
Yeah.
And that eventually stopped ringing because
how hard was that, though?
It's hard. Yeah. It is hard because they were mates, like, for that long sort of thing. And but then, you know, when you're trying to help yourself...
Yeah.
And that's...
And you did all that on your own, really. Yeah. You didn't have any help then. Yeah.
Cold turkey.
Yeah. What else? Were there any other things that you did? This is just for other, like, the blokes who watch this and listen and go, oh, well, what did he? Like, what were the practical things that you did? So you cut who you're hanging around.
Yep.
You went and you started.
That's when I started walking as well. So
you took up some exercise.
Yeah. Yep. And
do you think the exercise helped a lot with mentally?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah.
Because that was sort of like, at the start of when I stopped.
Yes.
And then I was walking a lot. And then the breakdown was actually when COVID first hit and, you know, you weren't allowed to go out.
Oh, yeah, we're all stuck.
So, that's when I lost the interest in walking. And then, the beers again. And then it just, that's when I sort of went into that bad section again with the headspace.
With that head noise happening. Yep. Yep. And that sometimes can come and go.
Yeah.
While we're trying to, I guess, sort through it. So, yeah, for blokes watching, I guess it's just refreshing there. You change who you're hanging around.
Yep.
You just add in a little bit of physical exercise and you were just concentrating on just the one thing, just walking.
Yeah,
wasn't it?
Yep, just walking.
You didn't worry
about
doing this and then going to go do that. So you just had two really simple things.
Small, simple steps.
Yep.
In the right direction.
Yeah, in the right direction. And you had, you had your sister, obviously, who's a rock for you and has helped you and supported you. And it's now 2021. You're here with us on Project Blokes and on our segment Blokes Tell 'em Blokes. I just want to touch base on something really quickly. Were there relationships that fell out during that time and that have now been repaired?
Yep.
Yeah. Do you want to touch on that at all?
About 2 years ago, I just stopped talking to my mum.
Yep.
And because like a long time ago, back when it all first started, I actually said to her that I thought something was wrong.
Yeah.
And she laughed that's your mother and that sort of. I was like, well, shit. You know, that's a kick in the guts, but Yeah, so I didn't talk to her for a couple of years, and then so just recently started talking again, and
yeah,
it's pretty much like the last 2 years where we haven't talked, wasn't even there sort of thing. Like it's still a good relationship as far as I'm aware of, and so I shouldn't have been angry at her because she's no doctor, so it's not her fault, but. It was a hard response to take in with that. So,
did you just gonna touch? So you said something really, really important there, bro. That it. So did you hold that against her? Her whole lot. Did you or did you kind of?
No, I didn't. I didn't hold it against her. I just thought.
Would you get angry at it?
Yeah, I was a little angry because that's my mother, and I thought the response would have been a bit better than what I got, sort of thing. And yeah, that messed with me a little, but.
And you said something just then, man. I'll help you. You know, you said something just then about as it's like just recently you realised that wasn't her fault.
Yeah,
she didn't understand.
Yeah.
So I guess what I'm hearing is it sounds like you kind of forgave your mum for something. She didn't even realize she'd done it.
Yeah,
she didn't realize you're also.
Because I'm pretty sure we're on the piss too. So
So. Well, that's massive. Like that's big for a bloke to go. Yeah. I mean, blokes these days. Oh, you know, we work.
Yeah,
You know, you hear the stuff they say. That would have been pretty big for you to go. Well, you know what? She doesn't even know that.
Yeah.
That happened. And and you've kind of forgiven her for it. That's unreal, and that's kind of brought your. Allowed you to go, let's fix this.
Yeah.
Fix this up. And do you reckon you would have been able to do that still under the influence?
Nah, not a chance. Yeah.
Unreal, man.
Yeah, not a chance.
That's good. Well, so what's on the cards now for Timmy? What you got any plan? Are you gonna stay with the railway or
I'll stay there for a bit. Just see what happens. Might look at other jobs in the future sort of thing, but see how it goes first.
And, do you have any final words for, as a bloke telling other blokes, do you have anything like struggling or listen who will watch this?
Yeah, try and find someone solid who you can open up to, and it'll be a lot easier to talk about what troubles you're having. And we do recover. So yous can do it, fellas, if yous are struggling. Don't hold it in. It wrecks you more.
I might go down to the river, 'cause the way that the sky opens up when we touch it, it's making me say that the way you hold me